here mentioned 38. 38, actually from here to here, this is 38. And we briefly mentioned just now 58 point something is actually measuring from here to the top here. So this is 58. Now from here to here is 38, but from here to here is actually 58. Now 58, of course, on top here, these are the lighter one because this is where the antenna extended. Antenna actually run parallelly with this concrete structure. Okay, if you look at the next slides. You can see from here. Now, also just now mentioned that the water tank and lift core, beside the water tank, there are also some lift core along here. This is where the existing freestanding structure at this moment that we have on top of this. And this is the fin wall along here. This is the fin wall. And you can see this is a tie beam. From drawings, we will be able to tell whether this tie beam is a tie beam that holding the structure or is a tie beam just for the slab on top of this. We also have some pictures show that this tie beam actually also gave way. This one is the one that the structure that the subject matter that we're talking about along here. Okay, the next slide. Okay, here we have some video presentation, a short one, and showing what happened immediately after the incident. Before this slide. Yeah. Okay, this is happening immediately after that. What I would like all of us to pay attention is the how much upheavement the whole slab has actually gone up. Now, why is an upheavement? Because any amount of concrete went into the ground, they will upheave all the soil up. So, and of course there will be some compaction as well. But as you can see there, there's actually a lot of volume that actually come out. But this amount of volume came out, and is still lesser than the volume of concrete that went in, because there will be some compactions and consolidation took place. Okay, and of course water pipe and all this, the burst, and then you can see. And this is the top part. Okay, after I will share with you what we speculate what happened during the incident when it took place at the 6:45. You see this is before, and this is after. And this is the concrete structure, and we again speculate that this concrete structure was put up because they are using this concrete structure to hold the antenna. Okay, they use a concrete structure to hold the antenna. Now, we are not in a position to comment about what they've done, the design. So we're based on the factual and to share what we encountered. This structure all came down, okay, during the wind. Now, I also collected some findings. This wall, we also believe that has caused the wind concentrate on this area. It's something like eventually when it happens, because this wall is holding back the wind, therefore the wind are all focusing on this point. So they added to the design consideration when they do the design, whether they have done this part or not. Okay, this is what we have requested them to find out. And so when this thing came down, and after that it become like this. Now this one is like torn down. If you see some structure, we do not know. We do not know whether there's one possibility, like CM mentioned, it could be a whole column all the way. It could be also a freestanding structure. But if you have a freestanding structure, then the anchoring here must be able to withstand the wind load. Okay, not just only the vertical load, but also the wind load. Yeah, the wind load not only from the surface of this. Let's say if you were to design the wind load, then you calculate what's the wind speed and things like that. But because of these slabs, the wind may have concentrated on the area. Okay, next slide. Now this is what happened. This picture was taken from our Bilik Rakan at the museum. This is Menara Amno. This is the incident's location, and the Pata shop, and the mosque, and also the museum. It came down this way, okay? It came down this way, and it hit on this ground, okay? This is the road. This one, I enlarged it here. This particular car actually was moving from Komta direction to Pulau Tikus, okay? And when it hits down from the scrap that we found from the car, and also not able to locate the body, and from the car, the shape, it seems that it hits at one part of the car, driver side. And because of the height and the weight, the whole concrete structure actually shear off the car. It's like scissor. So because the impact is so great, and the time of contact is so minimum, it just shear it off. So this part of the body couldn't be located, and the body also couldn't be located. So we are speculating that this portion may have gone down much deeper. How deep, we wouldn't know, but it would be definitely deeper than where we discovered the car body. The car body was discovered at about 8-9 meters deep. I would say that including the bottom part, maybe 10 meters. So it will be below that. It will go much lower than that. Now, it is also not able to go further down to take the concrete out and find some more the car bodies, because when the excavator went down and scratched the side of the hole, and we found that it's all concrete. You can hear all the sound, like, you know, all the concrete sound when you scratch the concrete. So that's even much deeper. Therefore, also give us the evidence to say that the structure that went in is actually very, very deep. And now, how deep? We can make some assumptions, which I'm going to share later. This side is the car. The car after got shoved, and behind the concrete falling, continued to fall down, and crashed the car. And the car is only left with 1.2 meters to another dimension, maybe 1.5 meters. So it's all crumbled. You know, it's like a ball, like a metal ball. Yeah? It's like a piece of metal ball. Okay? And of course, the bomba helps us to cut and then lay it on the surface. The cushions and all these are all there. Part of the engines are all there. Even the gearbox is all in pieces. It's not one piece, it's pieces. Yeah? The impact is very, very high. Because the concrete structure is 38 meters, we took out a dimension and fell 21 story. So you can imagine the impact. Okay? There were one report, of course I don't have a chance to verify, and then it was reported and said that the impact is like 16 buses full load, concentrated on that small area. Yeah? Yeah, my expectation is more than 130 ton, but the report say it's 130 ton. You felt that it's 3-4, so with the G-force, the speed is, it's a few seconds for the 21 floor. So the speed is very, very high. It's almost a 3-4, okay? So this part of the car, the one that I got shut off, and the plan view is here. Okay, go to the next slide. Now, you can see from here, okay, this is the part that came down, this part. This one is still standing. Okay. Next one. You can see this part that came down. The wall existing currently still standing is here. Okay. There are some thin wall here for decoration, and it also hit by this, and it just nice to touch a little bit of the edge, and it came down from here. Okay. Next one. This is from the top. This is the thin wall that I mentioned just now, that it was just touched by the concrete structure, and all the way it got scratched. Yeah, the whole thin wall. Another one. Okay, this is another view. Okay, this is the beam that I mentioned just now briefly, the tie beam. Okay, so we do not know whether this tie beam is to tie back this structure, or it's a perimeter beam for this slab. But this tie beam also gave way. You go back again. Yeah, this tie beam totally gave way and almost fell down. It's only held by some reinforcement. Yeah, so what they've done is that they quickly take this beam down. Otherwise, this one is just a matter of time, because left only a few reinforcement holding it. There's no way to hold this beam because of the weight. Yeah. Okay. You can see the next one. This is what we are worried about. And again, we are in no positions to say anything about the design. But judging from what we see from the site, very minimum reinforcement. That's the reason why I think it is a good action that the council has taken to issue the letter to suggest to the developer as well as the party involved in the design to quickly investigate. Because if this is the design philosophy used, and if this philosophy is used for the other the other freestanding slabs, and then with the same work methodology, it may create concern. Yeah, so that's why it is the right thing that council has done to immediately ask them to work within 7 days to come back with a report and also get their competent person to certify and endorse that the other slab is actually safe. Okay, the next one. As you can see, we are lowering down the beam and to make sure that it doesn't have another free fall from this beam. Okay, and you can see, go back, you can see this is the lapping of the reinforcement. So this one gives us a lot of evidence to suggest that this one can be a concern area. Okay, the next one. Now, this slide is very important to share because this one suggests that the top part fell down first because of the bend. Okay? Now, if the bottom one fell first, this part will not bend this way. So this one suggests that actually when the wind blow, the structure actually fell this way. Okay? And it fell this way, it also bent one part of the antenna that it was freestanding originally. And then the rest actually went down. Okay, I'll show you another slide, which is okay. Now this one show you the upheavement. The volume that upheaved from the entire site is a lot. The impact area, very minimum. Yeah, it's like a punch, it's like just like not punch in, it's like poke in, you know. It's like poke in with that 30 over meters of concrete. And that length is tremendous. Okay, you can see the volume that upheaved, almost the entire site. Okay, this one is the joint. This one I wanted to share a little bit more because we believe that this is the top part of the concrete. Okay, not the bottom part. The bottom part went in, and if what we suspect, it went this way and then it came down. Before it become vertical, it actually hit one part of it. And the top part broken. So the top part broken left externally, including those that you see with all the reinforcement, is approximately 10 meters. So there's another 30 meter missing. So we believe after it break the top part, the rest actually went in straight. There's no evidence, you cannot find where is the concrete. So but when we start hacking, we saw the base and it's huge concrete. Now this is we believe is a top part. Of course, some is very bottom part, but when I look at the dimension, it taper and becomes smaller. So it gives us a lot of evidence this is the top part. Now, when we say the other part actually went in, because you can see the steel, or we call it reinforcement, actually bent downward, not upward. So if you break, the reinforcement should be bent upward. But this one, it bent downward because reinforcement is still joining after the concrete got broken. And then the rest can actually bend in. Yeah, so the reinforcement actually got snapped, and then the big portion actually bend in through this hole. Okay, now unfortunately, that particular car get dragged down by this big piece that went down. Not the whole car, if they hit the whole car will gone in. But they hit one section only, and that's why it gets sheared off. But the car get dragged down by about 5 to 6 meters down, one part. The other major part were as deep as almost 8 meters down. Then, but the small part, we can't find. Okay, we go back to the other one. And next slide. And this is another view to show the top part. Now, this is the moss, I believe. Yeah, this is the moss. This is the moss, and this is the top part. The big portion is actually behind here. Here also broken some, but the main broken part is here. You look at the next one. Okay. And you can see the impact point actually is not large. Go to the next one. Okay, this is the impact point. Okay, this is where the whole big piece went down straight from here. Okay, and the small piece is actually on top, which is about exposed now is about 8 meters. Front part 1 meter broken, and another 1 meter here. So altogether is about 10 meters. So 30 meters of concrete actually missing. And we excavated down to almost 8-9 meters, and then about 8 meters, including the car portion, another 1-2 meters. So we believe that inside, from where we excavated, there will be another easily 20 to 22 meters of concrete. Okay, vertically down. Okay, okay, go to the next slide. Now, this one we got it from the one of the press. I think they took what we deliberated during the briefing at the Bilik Karakan. And this one gives us some graphical pictures and how it hits the car with the driver's seat, and then how it fell, and where are the longer version and portion, and where are the shorter version portion. Okay. Now, this one also in line with what we speculated technically, because when it hits, the car actually went vertically backside up. So the first portion of the car discovered was actually the back bonnet and also the number plate, as well as one small piece of backlights. And when we discovered the bigger portion, also shows that the back wheel was on top and the front wheel at the bottom. Somebody asked in one of the questions, how do you know whether it's the back wheel or front wheel? From the car, you know, where you place the absorber and what kind of size of absorber. You can see, you can tell whether it's the back wheel or front wheel. Okay. Next one. Now, this is the part showing the antenna and some cladding. This one is on the road surface. This is the top part of the antenna. Just on the broken one is actually at the middle part. Next one. Okay, you can see the amount of steel that exposed after the breakage. Next one. Okay, some upheavement beside. These are some shots taken from the video clip just now. Okay, now you can't do anything at all, because you see nothing, you only see a hole, you see some concrete, and then you can't do much. So they have to mobilize the breaker, and together the excavator to use the breaker to break the concrete, so they can get, you can go down. Okay, next one. Okay, another breaker wheel to break the concrete. This portion is not big. So if you say it lay flat, you should have exposed the whole length. But the surface area for this impact point is very minimum. Okay. Now you can go back. You can see the steel that exposed. Now this is the concrete that exposed. Okay, after we break it, and it's a big area. Almost the whole impact point is just only filled of concrete, and after breaking is all the reinforcement. Okay, at this level is about 2-3 meter from the road surface. Okay, the next one. This bomba start to look at the, when we start putting in a lot of deep sheet power. The initial one, because the material availability, we put in 3 to 6 meter immediately and started working. When the next batch of the SIPA 9 meter one came in, we continued to power, and that's how we managed to get into below 5 meter at about 6 meter and or 5.5 meter. We saw one wheel, we saw one of the wheel, and which is still intact with the car. This wheel was still attached with the car, and we tried to pull it out, but there's no way. We didn't want to force it because it may break. So if it break, then we may miss the whole car body below. Okay, and but this side, and this side, no way to excavate, because this concrete, we cannot touch the base. When we put the excavator down, and we can only scratch the concrete. So there's no way to do any excavation from here, unless you again go into breaking. But there's no end, because from the side it tells us it's very, very deep. Okay, and so this portion of the car actually is covered at this area. Okay, and the wheel, we managed to locate the wheel, and you go to the next slide. Excavator to pull, and we have a lot of plan A and plan B. During the ship piling, we have plan A, 3 to 6 immediately available one, we start doing it, or waiting for the deeper one to come, and trying to hoist this thing up. We also have plan A using the excavator, one number doesn't work, two numbers. Then, but at the same time, we also managed to found one crane, which is 360 ton, and this is the only one number in the northern Malaysia. Usually they use it for hoisting of a bridge. Okay, and it came in, but we were using the excavator to try first. Okay, next one. Now so finally the crane arrived, and we put bomba in to this one is after the wheel, and then using the excavator, I think we can't work. Maybe we use a crane, but unfortunately, it got snapped. And at that point of time, most of us almost gave up, and we said, well, we come to a point, you just have to stop. Primarily because of the safety of the surrounding. Because the shorter ship power already begin to give way, and luckily we got the second layer of paper ship power, but we can see that the movement continue to come in because the soil condition at this area is actually very bad. I would say very soft. Very, very soft, it's all marine clay. And so this one is very, very free. Yeah. During the course of actions, intermittently there's a lot of rains as well, and there were a few occasions at about 3 o'clock as well as another one at 4 o'clock, it was very heavy pour. So for the workers' safety, we actually stopped for about 15 minutes, and another one stopped for another 15-30 minutes, okay, because of the safety of the workers. And so after that, we tie the body. Hopefully it doesn't get dismantled, and you go to the next one. Now this is the car body that taken out. Initially was a lump, like a metal ball, and only with a dimension of 1.2 meters to 1.5 meters. And but we break it up, and this is how we discovered the car bodies. Okay, but the front seat is missing, and the driver's seat is missing, and a big portion of the front right hand side is missing, and but the rest all we discovered. The cushions and all this we discovered. Okay? So I think this one will give you a snapshot of idea what's happening at the site. Is there any more? I think this is the last one, right? Yeah, that's the last one.
Any questions?
Well, they arrive at about 2-3 o'clock at night, and immediately they do the installation. And so after the installation of deeper power, and then we continue for another 2-3 meters. 2/3 meters. So then that's how we discovered the wheel, the back wheel that attached with the car body. Yeah. So there were two batches of steel, one at about 3-4 meters, the other one at about 5-6 meters.
Yeah,
with the 9 meter ship out. And also the 6 meter ship out, we fully utilize it because we also have some open car, and then therefore we can actually drive a deeper. Because for the workers' safety, for the task force safety, and also for the stability of the surrounding, but mainly because of the workers' safety, we cannot excavate more than what is allowed for. Because usually what is exposed is half, and then the same dimension as what is embedded. So we can only do that 1-to-1. And but this time we took a little bit of risk because if we saw something, we actually exceed a little bit, okay, and be beyond 1-to-1. But then we have to stop until we explore the 9 meter pass. For design, it's not fair for us to comment without really looking into the calculations and design and things like that. Because their design philosophy, design concept, it's only the competent person who designed the building know best. So there are many ways to do a design. So I think that one, please let them have an opportunity to look at it. Come back, and as well as MTPP also have all the drawings, and MTPP can also review from there to see whether it tallies about their findings. So I think we have to leave it to the. That's the reason why it's also to speed up the process, get the owners or the developers, a competent person to do a quick check. It's faster than having another set of people to do the checking. Yeah. Okay, but meanwhile MTPP also have all the drawings, which they will also review it. And then we'll tally with the findings and feedback from the developer's consultant. Okay. Now, I think to answer to your question, generally speaking, and all design of this height, following the design code and guideline, there's a minimum wind load that we must consider for all structure. If you use the BS standard, British standard, even American standard, there's a wind load that we require. But Malaysia's building, do not require for typhoon or all this excessive wind load. So we do not have that. Like earthquake, we also do not have that requirement. But even though we doubt, but if you design the building properly, it can also withstand certain amount of earthquake and all this. But for wind load, yes, there's a minimum wind load that call for in the design code. Minimum wind load.